about India. I left India when I was 16 years old, stayed there, was educated there, but never took the citizenship of the United States. Still have an Indian passport, even though it's very, very difficult. I guess that doesn't work. Every time I go to Europe, they give me a hard time. With an American passport, you can go any place in the world. So I do love my country, but I do have some concerns. And I just want to share with you a few things. I teach at Berkeley, I teach building smart cities. But all the classes that I teach are focused on India. My students have developed models for the three cities that Obama and Modi have selected, which is Amaravati, Allahabad, and Vizag. We presented to the Minister of Urban Development, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu, who was applauding that first. He said, you know, next time you do a class, do it in my city, Vizag. So my students did a course on smart cities for Vizag alone recently. Half my students are engineers, they build technologies to make a smart city. The other half are business students who build business models around those technologies. And Mr. Chandrababu Naidu pulled me aside. I had three meetings with him. Every time we had sat down for dinner, he would call me to his table and said, I want you to focus on building or prototyping smart villages. And that's the course I'm teaching now. At Berkeley, and I'll talk more about that tomorrow when I get a chance. But a few thoughts. I guess there are five things that, because we're all, Dr. Agarwal was talking about, we need a strong economy. There are five things that contribute to the economic growth. The first is innovation. We are an innovative country. We have it. What made America great and what kept it going over the years is innovation. It's through technology. It is always technology that when we wrap around the technology business models that produces economic growth. That's one thing. The second thing is openness. The openness of a country to conduct trade. That's what made America great. That's what's going to make India great. The openness of a country to conduct trade. The third is institutions. The stability of institutions. America has prospered because it has great, stable institutions, whether it's the Federal Reserve, the monetary system. All of the institutions are stable, so we can invest in that country. And I think India is getting there. The fourth one is population. The reason that America has prospered so well is that it's not only the population that expanded, but it's the right population, the brain drain. My father went there in the 60s. He's a scientist. He contributed to the economy. So when you have the right population growing, and we have a wonderful young population in India that love education, I'm working with them, right? So that population growth, the right population growth, were not parasites, but we contribute, were differently to that. The United States has benefited from that. The last one, America is not doing so well. It's the savings. We are one of the most debtor nations in the world. We're not doing well. But India has an advantage here because Indians are savers, are Chinese. So we have a lot of lot going for us. And those are the things that will make India, I think, take us deep forward. The United States has gone through the most deepest and the longest recession in history. You can see how this dark line is so deep and long. The previous recessions, United States just a little dip and recovered very quickly, but this one was a terrible one. The United States had gone through the deepest and the longest recession in history. But however, we are recovering. Why are we recovering? What's causing this recovery? And I'll tell you why. And the good news is we are recovering faster than any other economy in the world. We're doing better than UK, Japan, right? The Eurozone, we're recovering faster than any other country. What can we learn from this? Here's a history map, basically. America has gone through World War I, World War II, the Great Depression, Korean War, Vietnam War, first oil crisis, second oil shock. We had the 9/11. We had this biggest recession. But look at the map, look at the graph. We have still managed to grow at an average of 3%. No economy has done. What is behind this wonderful news is another thing, as those of you who are into taxes. America's done well during the high tax seasons, low tax seasons, right? The tax policy had nothing to do with the economic growth. We still grew at 3%. So this is why America looks at bright side and we can learn something from it. Number one, over the long period of time, we have demonstrated to the world, right, with all the massive changes and reforms, that we're still growing. We have demographic changes, we have policy, we have technology, political changes, but U.S. has enjoyed a remarkable steady economic growth because of all of these problems, because of this thing here called innovation. When I hear the word innovate for India, it means that we got it. India got it. That's where it begins. It's innovation. It's responsible because all of these innovations, the United States, beginning from Model T, right now we have Tesla, of course, right? And the driverless car, right? Beginning from that, all of these things, now we have cognitive computing, IBM Watson, a course that I teach at Berkeley, the supercomputer, right? We're cloud, we have all of this. It is always the innovativeness that will move us forward. And with so many young people in our country who are so desirous, who have the zeal and zest to move forward, I think we can never lose. We can bet on India. So despite all this, we have propelled forward in America, and I think we have definitely improved our standards. So there are four frameworks that I would like to share, if I have time, and unless Dr. Agarwal says I need to sit down. And these are the things I would say will build strong economies. The first one is called the leadership framework. The second is triple helix. How many of you heard the word triple helix? Oh, good. We have a couple of people who heard triple helix, that's good. There's a double helix, it's the DNA, right? Triple helix for a nation to move forward, we also need a DNA, but I call it triple helix, and I'll explain to you what that is. And India is right there. The third one is called open innovation framework. I teach at Berkeley, I teach at a center called the Garvan Center for Corporate Innovation. Anita and I come from there to talk to us. Berkeley is so proud to have the father of this concept, open innovation, and teaching at Berkeley, and he's the faculty director in the Chesterov. And he's the faculty director and the executive director. We'll talk about what that means and how it would help us very quickly. The last one is a business model framework. And I'll tell you how that works. Framework one. I think India got it right because leaders need to make things happen. They're visionary. They cast your vision and people rally around it or galvanize around it. Whether it's Chandrababu Naidu or Modi, they didn't think about where the money is going to come from for all the smart cities. The first question that people ask Modi is, where will you get all this money from? People were not even worried about that, but they were fascinated by the vision. They make things happen. Number two, they also galvanize kind of people around them that are two types, executives and people who are dynamic with dynamic capabilities. These people here that Modi and Chandrababu Naidu and people like that, right? These are, we need executive people who do things right. Right, they are technical efficient, you know, they get it done, right? And we have these people. And I think Mr. Chandrababu Naidu, when the first thing he did was he brought in the right people on the bus. If you have the wrong people on the bus is not going to go any place. We need the right people. And the wrong people should get off the bus. And there's another group of people here that Mr. Naidu always seems to get. And these people do the right things. These people break all the rules. They are street smarts. They sense, seize, and transform. It's like in America, we call it street smart. When you walk around, you're aware of who's around you. It's almost like you have eyes all around you. And you are sensing and seizing the environment. And those are dynamic. And they break rules. And they change things. And they transform. And they seize the moment. Right? So we need these kind of people. And so, and but the thing is, this is the thing, is this is easy to do, but this is difficult to do. And I think if you look at Modi government, or Chandrababu Naidu government, they've got the right kind of people. Just the fact that we have Dr. Agarwal as the CEO of the Innovation Society, and J.A. Chowdhury, you know, and who's brought in, who built the high-tech city, that itself makes a statement that dynamic capabilities are valued. Right? I met Amitabh Kant the other day. Another message that Modi said, you come in here, you need to help me. Dynamic capabilities. The reason this is important for India, this is the old way of doing things. The way we did it was, if we have a lot of military capability, we move and we, that's how we won the war. A lot of assets. More assets you have, the better off you are. But this doesn't work anymore. We live in a world that is so transforming, so fast. The landscape is changing. This doesn't work anymore. Let me show you the new way. The new way is all about, not about assets, but orchestration. You need few assets, but you need to deploy them fast and very quickly. All right? So heavy emphasis on soft assets, okay, to deploy the forces much faster. And the key success factor here is rapid deployment. While the other one, on this side here, is all about the balance sheet. How many assets do you have? What do you have? Today's models work on no assets. The state of Andhra Pradesh began with ground zero, had no assets. But look at what Chandrababu Naidu is doing. It's all about how you use other people's balance sheets. Let's use Singapore's balance sheet. Bring them in. So you need zero assets. You use other people's assets to make things work for you. This dynamic capabilities. You don't need your own. See, these people cannot take a U-turn. By the time they take a U-turn, it's too late. These guys communicate fast, real time, and they go by fast. A different paradigm shift for us. So the capabilities, okay, what is essential is no longer on the balance sheet. Actually, everything that is not essential is on the balance sheet. The garbage is on the balance sheet. So what they're saying is the capabilities have migrated to people, to enable them in this digital age. And we, in India, 66% of our population are young people who are dynamic, who think digitally. They don't think this. They think this. My little daughter, 8-year-old, she knows everything about the iPhone. When I get stuck, I have to say, honey, can you show me how to do this? She'll tell me. She hasn't been to college yet. She's 8, but she knows everything. And every time she tells me a solution to a problem, it's all digital. She's light years ahead. Right? And that's the advantage India has going forward. So there's a, in this framework, I would like to conclude, which is called the leadership framework, by two famous men. One is a king. The king is a remarkable king. He never fought a single war in his lifetime. He established banking, he established commerce, world trade. In fact, he brought the enemies of his father, who was a terrible king, who shed a lot of blood, to the peace table and said, let's not fight, let's collaborate. Let's work together and establish trade and commerce and create value for each other. That's the kind of world we live in. And that is King Solomon. King Solomon said, actually his settlements, the early Jewish settlements in India go back to his time in Kutcher. He created Maharajas, he gave them horses, he bought silk and spices, right? Because horses in those days were like the tanks like today, because that's how kings fought. So the fastest horse, King Solomon. And this is what he said. He said, where there's no vision, people perish. That's exactly what Modi has done, Chandrababu Naidu has done, is they cast a vision to galvanize people behind them. Otherwise, King Solomon is saying, my people will perish if I do not cast a vision. Right? And it's passion that transforms, right, vision into reality. That's what we need. We have that already. We have that on the table. I think India is moving forward, and I think that's great. Here's another man. I'm so honored today to be here at Cambridge, because my name is Darwin, and Darwin went to school here. And my family, my daughters, emailed me this morning. Nina, she said, you're there where Darwin was. I said, yes. I thought I always wanted to be here. My dad is a scientist, he's a marine biologist. He believed when I was born, he was doing his thesis in marine biology, and he believed in that life came from the oceans. So he named me Darwin. So ever since then, I was curious about this guy, and now I'm here at Cambridge, where he went to school, to quote him. What he has to say is so relevant for us today. Vision is important, but the second most important thing is adaptability. He said, it is not the strongest of the species that survives. Not the most intelligent that survives. It is the one that is most adaptable to change. You may have a vision. Change course as you walk around. Modi is doing that, so each other overnight. Now there's a shift from smart cities to smart villages. Why? Because they say, well, maybe got something wrong here. And we are there. We're adapting. We're also having a vision. We're moving in that direction. We have oneness of aim and singleness of effort. So we're doing that right. The second framework is called the Triple Helix Framework. Very, very important for us. I was called to Russia 3 times. And one time the Prime Minister was in the audience, and I told him, every time I go to Russia or China, I'm going to Colombia next week, they always just ask this question, how do we create the Silicon Valley right here? We want to create a Silicon Valley in our country. But I went to Russia, I said, you cannot. I'm sorry, you cannot do it. I thought they'd shoot me because they never invited me, but they did invite me again, but I told them the same thing. It has to do with this thing called triple helix. And it works for America. America is not the best model or the perfect model, but it is a model that has demonstrated that this works. All right? It all has to do with Bharat. It's about the knowledge. Right? That's what Dr. Agarwal was talking about, right? You need, actually, creation of knowledge, right? And because you need money, okay, you need to create knowledge. Universities do that very well, right? Innovation turns knowledge into money. If you don't have ideas, If you don't have knowledge, you can't create value for people. But you need another thing here, which for the triple helix, a third party who make things happen. Often it's the government. In America, government, the United States, was very much involved in the creation of Silicon Valley because it funded two of the most famous universities, UC Berkeley and Stanford. So much money went into that research there. So much knowledge was created to put out the enemy. And later it created commercialized products from that knowledge. When the war was over, Silicon Valley. But it began with the government funding it, right? So I think India can benefit from this. I think we got it, right? So it's a triangle. What do the government does? The government funds, right? And creates knowledge to universities. Universities create startups around the Boston area, around Silicon Valley, around wherever the universities are. The economy has the highest GDP creation. Why? Because those knowledge centers, right, created jobs, created startups. Then what do businesses do? They pay the government back with taxes. The whole idea is to create taxpayers, not people, but people who can work and add value, so taxes are coming back. So this cycle continues, and I think the United States has been a good example of that. And the reason it doesn't work elsewhere in the world, and I told Russia this, is you have everything. You have more PhDs than all of Europe combined. You have oil. Your power, but you lack one thing. And that one thing is you don't have the culture. Because Silicon Valley was not created overnight. It's like good wine. It took time. We failed so many times, but we kept up and kept walking and kept innovating, right? And that's what happened. The reason it doesn't work is this is Russia, right? Or it could be China. The government is too big. And then you have these, so in order for the triple helix to work, all three circles have to be equal. Otherwise, these die inside. You need the government to be just enough size. You need the knowledge centers to be just enough size and same thing with that. And it leads to that the flow has to happen. And if it doesn't happen, you get choked. And that's why China, as great as it is, I think we have a better model. I think India can adapt to this, adapt to the triple helix, and I think grow from there. So framework number three is called open innovation, and I'll conclude in a couple of minutes. Open innovation has to do with knowledge flows. When knowledge is created, it has to flow. Knowledge is useless unless it flows, unless it creates value. Otherwise, knowledge sits on the shelf, collects dust, is no good. What Henry Chesbrough is saying is that knowledge, this is R&D, research and development. In most companies and different countries, you can have ideas come through, all the dots are ideas. This is a funnel. Closed funnel, right? But only some ideas that are useful to that company go through and become marketable products, okay? And the problem with this model, okay, is this. It used to work. Actually, closed innovation, which is one way in, one way out, nothing goes out, you only have one way to go in, and that is closed innovation. What made America great, as a great country, is closed innovation. You know why? Because we took knowledge and we held it as an asset on the balance sheet and kept it as a secret, did not share it with anybody else. We gave money to others. So we treated knowledge as a stock and we put a fence around it and said, we want to safeguard it. that doesn't work anymore. It used to work. Actually, during the war times, World War I, World War II, the Vietnam War, 70% of the PhD thesis of Stanford at Berkeley, the sciences, was classified as toxic. Why? Because we didn't want our enemies to have it. But with that knowledge, made us a lot of money. But it doesn't work because now we live in a world of what? Internet. The gates are open. There are calls every place. The guy who works for Facebook today works for Dell tomorrow. Mm-hmm. He works in India and he comes to Silicon Valley. He goes to China, he works there in Singapore. So knowledge is flowing. It flows very fast. It flows from high to low at speeds that's unimaginable. By the time knowledge is created in the Silicon Valley, it's already in the manual. Someone is innovating faster than you, right? That is knowledge. So this is not working. So this is the, I have a little, maybe you can see this very quickly. A company called Xerox PARC hired the best scientists after World War II is over, PhDs, and said, guys, innovate. Innovate and come up with the best ideas that you could produce a faster machine with better fonts. So what happened was, people who began to do this discovered so many phenomenal things unrelated to the Xerox machine. The stuff that you use today on your iPhone and iPad, they discovered it. But Xerox said, don't use these technologies because it doesn't really help out the Xerox machine. So people left. People left the company. And so this is actual flow. So people left and they created these companies. The moral of the story here for us is when you hold knowledge captive, right, you die. You cannot do that anymore. So look at Xerox today, right? It could have really had all of these technologies and benefited from that. So the companies that left Xerox had a higher market cap than Xerox itself. So Xerox created the value, but failed to capture the value because of this generation. And I think there's a lesson for India there. We need to create that value for the world and capture a portion of it so we sustain ourselves. So I will quickly conclude here. So this is the way we need to think about our future to grow our economy. It's still a funnel. Knowledge has to flow. We have three targets: current market, new markets, and other people. So everything. So we have to have holes. Knowledge doesn't go one way in, one way out. It has many ways in and many ways out. No, not an ounce of knowledge that is created sits on the shelf, collects dust. It does invigorate, be useful to society. I believe any knowledge that's created belongs to society. No one should capture it. Otherwise, you'll rob the society of many things. So even ideas are coming in. They may hit our market. Some, if you don't use it, give it to someone else. License it, right? Or maybe you have something that you can create a new market. Okay, don't put it on the shelf, right? And here's someone else's knowledge. You bring it in because you have other things. India's good in one thing, China's good in another thing, so bring it in and launch new markets, right? And this is the way we need to think today. This is a boomerang. It's our idea that comes through. We don't know, we'll give it to someone else, maybe some other country. They innovate and bring it back in, and we launch new markets. So the idea, the takeaway from this open innovation is, when knowledge is created, let's not hold it as an asset. Let's capture the value. So I'll skip this one because I'm running out of time here. Should I quit now?
I think it should be okay.
Huh?
Yep. You can take some questions if
you have. Oh, let me take quick questions. If I have any, but you know what this is? These are the people who got the Nobel Prize for the Frank system. 1948. Do you know who shipped out the first transistor? Who shipped out the first transistor? It's not AT&T. It was a company that was unknown at the time. Came out of the ashes of World War II from Japan. It's called Sony. So after 10 years, Sony ships out the first transistor for $39. Why? Because knowledge was held captive in these people's heads. They didn't want to let go. Let me contrast that for today, how knowledge flows and how much fast that is. Here's the iPod. And I ask people, who created the iPod? Everybody says Steve Jobs. But they are wrong. He's not the one who created it. Actually, the guy who created it, it's not even Apple. It was a company called Philips. There's a guy by the name of Tony Fadell who discovered this thing, and he said, you know, he went to the CEO and said, I have something remarkable here. And the CEO said, you know, shut up, go back to your desk, you mind your business, this is a crazy idea. So Tony went to different people's shoulders, he cried on their shoulders, and one of them was Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs said, I don't know anything about this technology. I have no idea what it, how do you begin? But let's talk to our friends. So they talked to all these people. Some of them are, I heard, even Indian companies. They pooled their knowledge together. That's open innovation. And you know how long it took them from the time that idea came and took it to market? Not 10 years like Sony. 9 months. That is what we call convergence of knowledge coming through. When many people come together with their knowledge and pool it, things happen faster, quicker, there's speed to market. And I think India is in that business. I know how Chandrababu Naidu thinks, how Modi thinks. They're not sitting in silos and saying, well, this is why we're going to do it. They're collaborating and saying, welcome people, scientists, knowledge pools, come, set up your companies, let's work together. And that is why I feel India is going to move much faster, much greater. There's one more framework. I don't think I'll have time to do it because I took too much time right now. It's called the business model framework. Phenomenal. Maybe I'll share it tomorrow. Any questions? So they're all tired of my misspeaking. So, all right, thank you so much.
I think it's been an amazing speech, amazing insights. Thank you, Professor Solomon, for explaining the concept of open innovation.